హలో ఎవ్రీవన్, వెల్కమ్ టు మురళీధర్స్ క్లాస్ రూమ్. ఐఎమ్ వన్ ఆఫ్ ది స్టూడెంట్స్ ఆఫ్ మిస్టర్ కె మురళీధర్. ఫస్ట్లీ ఐఎమ్ వెరీ హ్యాపీ టు ఇంట్రడ్యూస్ మైసెల్ఫ్ త్రూ మురళీధర్స్ క్లాస్ రూమ్. ఐఎమ్ సర్వాణి దువోరి. ఐఎమ్ ఏ స్టూడెంట్ ఆఫ్ APIIIT RGKT ఇడుపుల్పాయ, అండ్ ఐఎమ్ పర్సూయింగ్ మై ఫస్ట్ ఇయర్ బీటెక్ ఇన్ ద డిపార్ట్మెంట్ ఆఫ్ సివిల్ ఇంజనీరింగ్. అండ్ నౌ ఐఎమ్ హియర్ టు గివ్ ఎ బ్రీఫ్ ఇంట్రొడక్షన్ అబౌట్ ఇంజనీరింగ్ మెకానిక్స్, విచ్ ఈస్ వన్ ఆఫ్ ది కో సబ్జెక్ట్స్ ఇన్ ద సివిల్ ఇంజనీరింగ్ డిపార్ట్మెంట్. టుడే అవర్ డిస్కషన్ ఇన్వాల్వ్స్ ద బేసిక్ టెర్మినాలజీ రిగార్డింగ్ మెకానిక్స్. లెట్ అస్ స్టార్ట్ అవర్ డిస్కషన్ విత్ ద డెఫినేషన్ ఆఫ్ మెకానిక్స్. వాట్ ఈజ్ మెకానిక్స్? మెకానిక్స్ ఇస్ ఎ బ్రాంచ్ ఆఫ్ ఫిజికల్ సైన్సెస్ విచ్ డీల్స్ విత్ ద బాడీస్ అండర్ ద అప్లికేషన్ ఆఫ్ ఫోర్సెస్. అవర్ మెకానిక్స్ ఇస్ డివైడెడ్ ఇన్ టు టూ టైప్స్. వన్ ఈజ్ స్టాటిక్స్ అండ్ ద అదర్ వన్ ఈజ్ డైనమిక్స్. ఫర్దర్లీ డైనమిక్స్ ఇస్ డివైడెడ్ ఇన్ టు టూ. వన్ ఈజ్ కైనెటిక్స్ and the other one is kinematics. Let us have a brief discussion on this. What is statics? Statics is the branch of mechanics which deals with the body's at rest condition. Then coming to the dynamics, dynamics is the branch of mechanics which deals with the body's in moving condition or the body's at rest. As we learn, kinetics and kinematics are also the branches of dynamics. Kinetics is it is a branch of mechanics, or we can say that it is branch of dynamics which deals with the forces. Here the forces means it is the cause for the motion. In kinetics we study about the causes. Then coming to the kinematics, we study the motion characteristics like acceleration, velocity and displacement. Here we do not bother about the cause. Next, moving further in detail, let us have some definitions like rigid body. Rigid body is nothing but a body which does not change its original shape under the application of any forces. That means, let us consider this is a body. If I apply some force in these directions, it does not change its body. This is known as the rigid body. Or in another way, we can say that if I consider two points on the surface of the rigid body like this, and if I apply the force in these directions, the distance between these two points will be always same even though I apply some force. This body is known as rigid body. What if the body changes its shape with the application of some forces? Then the body is known as deformable bodies. The other one is deformable body. That means the body which changes its original shape and position with the application of forces. Again, there are two types in this. One is elastic body and the other one is plastic bodies. What is elastic and what is plastic? Elastic body, it is a body which regains its original shape after the removal of forces. And coming to the plastic body, quite opposite to this, even after the removal of forces, it does not regain its original shape. Example for this is elastic rubber. If I apply some force and stretch the elastic rubber, it extends up to some limit, and after I release the force, it comes back to its original position. This is an example for elastic body. And coming to the plastic body, what we have discussed is it does not regain its original shape. That means we can say example for this any plastic bodies. Our next topic is now elastic limit. Elastic limit, it is the maximum limit up to which a body remains in elastic position. That means beyond that limit, a body will not act as the elastic body, it becomes a plastic body. For example, if this is the elastic body, suppose this is the limit, and if we apply the force beyond the elastic limit, this will never regain its original shape and behaves as a plastic body. Okay, coming to the some more definitions, let us discuss somewhat about the force, which plays a major role in physical sciences. What is the force? force. Let us have some clarification on force. Suppose take my hand. This is one body and my marker is another body. I am having some push on this body. That means my hand is doing some action on this marker. That means we can say that force is an action exerted by a body on another body. These forces are classified into eight types based on their location. First one, coplanar forces. This is the name itself. Coplanar forces means that the forces which will be acting in the same plane. That is, let us consider this as a plane, for example, and there are some forces like F1, F2, whatever be the direction. These are lying in the same plane. That means these are known as coplanar forces. Now, our second classification is concurrent forces. Concurrent forces means the forces which will meet at a point are known as concurrent forces. For example, this is a point and there are forces F1, F2 and F3 coming from the point. That means these forces met at a point and going away from this. So this can be said as concurrent forces. Another type is also, this is a point and the forces are coming towards the point like this. These are also said to be concurrent forces because these are going to meet at a point finally. So this can also be called as concurrent forces. Then the next classification is parallel forces. This means, as we know, that parallel means having no common point. That means the forces which does not have any common intersection point are known as parallel forces. Or in another way, we can define it as, if the distance between the two forces is always constant, then the forces are also known as parallel forces. Then our fourth classification is couple. Couple is also comes under the parallel forces with equal magnitude but opposite in direction. Let us see. Our fourth classification is couple. These are also parallel forces, means the distance between them is always constant, but they are equal in magnitude and opposite in direction always. This system forms a couple. Force 1 and force 2. This system is known as couple. And the distance is always constant. This couple is represented by force into distance. Okay. And our fifth classification is non-parallel and non-concurrent forces. Non-parallel and non-concurrent forces. This is in the name itself that these forces are non-parallel. That means which are not parallel to each other, and non-concurrent. Non-concurrent means does not meet at a single point. Let us have an example. Suppose this is a system we are having. These are the forces which are not parallel to each other and which are not having common intersection point. So this system is known as the forces with a non-parallel and non-concurrent. Then the next classification is like forces. What is meant by like forces? It is in the definition itself like. That means the forces should have some similarity. In what? Like forces means the forces which acts in the same direction irrespective of the magnitude. Example, this is the force F1, say, and this is the force F2. Even though the magnitudes of the force F1 and F2 are not equal, the both the forces are towards the same direction. So, these forces can be said as like forces. And our next classification, seventh classification, is equal forces. What is the difference between like and equal? Here the forces with equal magnitude are said to be equal forces irrespective of the direction. That means irrespective of the direction. Example, this is the force F1, this is the force F2, and both are with equal magnitudes. These are said to be equal forces. Okay. Then the last but not least classification of forces is collinear forces. That means the forces which are having the same line of action are said to be collinear forces. That means, say this is the force F1. This force is having the line of action in this direction. And this is the force F2. And this is having line of action in this way. So, the line of action of the both the forces lies in the same line. That means these forces are known as collinear forces. See another example. This is a force A and this is a force B. Even though those are opposite in directions, those are also having the same line of action. So these are also known as collinear forces. One more point to remember is all the collinear forces are like forces, but not all the like forces are collinear forces. For example, let us consider the Cartesian coordinates, Cartesian plane, x, y, y dash and x dash. Let us consider some points like this. There are four points lying on the x, x dash line. That means, so these points are said to be collinear points irrespective of the quadrants. Even though those are in different quadrants, they are said to be collinear points. In the same way for the forces also. Our next topic is the most fundamental topic, that is Newton's laws of motions. This plays a major role in mechanics. There are three laws in mechanics: first law, second law and third law. What is first law? What does it say? First law is also known as the law of inertia. It is defined as a body continues to be in the state of rest or in the uniform motion unless acted by an external force, also known as law of inertia. For example, consider this as a body. This is in the state of rest. No force is acting on this. Now I am applying some force on this. That means it changed its state of rest from to the state of motion. Unless and until a body is acted by a force, it continues to be in the state of rest or in the uniform motion. This is what Newton's first law says. And next, Newton's second law. We are familiar with the formula F equals to ma. That is, the force exerted on a body is directly proportional to the acceleration. That means, force is directly proportional to acceleration. Now, the proportionality is removed by the constant ma, where m is a constant and also the mass of the body. It can also be explained in the another way. Let us see. As we know that the kinematics has three laws. The first one is, from the first one, V is equal to U plus AT. From this equation, we can get A is equal to V minus U by T. And when we substitute this A equals to U plus V minus U by T in this equation, we get that M into V minus U by T. From this, F is equal to mv minus mu by t. This is what rho is equal to mv, is nothing but momentum, as we know. So, from this formula, we can define force, the external force, as external force is nothing but rate of change of momentum. This formula gives that. And next, coming to the third law. Third law is very familiar, as we know that action reaction force. It says that for every action there will be an opposite and equivalent reaction. Suppose, for example, a bird is flying in the sky. You can say that it pushes the air back with its wings so that it can move forward. That means, here action is the pushing air backward and the reaction is the moving bird forward. Here both forces are equal, but one is in backward direction and the other is in forward direction. This can be said as Newton's third law, which is nothing but action reaction. The next, one more law is that Newton's law of gravitation. According to this law, the force of attraction of gravitation is given by the relation F equals to g m1 m2 by r square, where g is the gravitational constant, where m1 and m2 are the masses of the particles, and r is the distance between the centers of the particles. That means, if I consider a particle with mass m1 and with mass m2 like this, the distance between the centers, this is considered as r. Okay. If a particle lies near to the surface of the earth, what happens? See, let us consider this as the surface of the earth and the particle is here, and we have to substitute this in the formula. This is of mass m1, this is the mass of the earth, that is g m e m. Here what we have to consider as r. See, the distance between the earth and the object is negligible, so we neglect that and we take the distance as the radius of the earth. Now our formula becomes g m e m by r e square. Separating these terms, g m e by r e square into m, because as the mass of the earth and radius of the earth are constant values, I separated those terms, and this value is given by g equal to 9.81 meters per second square. Now the equation is F equal to mg. Here we got a formula. Then what are the units? Force can be expressed in newtons. 1 newtons is equal to 1 kg into the g value is 9.81. So here 1 newton is equal to 9.81 kgs. Next, let us end up our discussion with a small topic, that is components of a force. See here, consider this as a block A. What happens if I apply the force in this direction? Let us say force F. I have applied a force F in this direction so that this block moves in the x direction, say. And the same block A, if I apply the force in upward direction, it moves in this direction. That means in y direction. What happens if I apply the force in an inclined way? This is the inclined force I applied. Now this block moves in both x and y directions. That means in this way and in this way. The block moves like this. So here the force F is divided into the components x and y. That means we have the components force Fx and Fy. To define those, we have a definition for components of forces. A force F is divided into the components Fx and Fy. And if the angle with the horizontal made is theta, then Fx and Fy are given by, see, this is our inclined force F. And it is making an angle theta with our horizontal, and say this is the y axis, that means Fy, y component, and this is Fx, x component. So from the figure, sin theta will be, as we know, opposite side by hypotenuse, that means Fy by F. Then the component Fy is equal to F sin theta. And from the same figure, cos theta will be, cos theta is adjacent side by hypotenuse, so that Fx by F. From here we can get x component, that is Fx is equal to F cos theta. So these are the formulas which were used in the problem solving. And in the next class, we will discuss about the problems. Thank you. For more lessons, please subscribe Muralidhar's Classroom. Thank you.